Happy morning, my dear students. We are discussing topics in unit number 1. So unit number 1 is related to the multi-core processor. In yesterday's class we discussed about the SIMD and MIMD system, and at the end of yesterday's class I told you that today we will discuss about interconnect networks. Okay, so today we are going to start discussing about interconnect networks. So interconnect networks, so this is a topic in unit number 1. So to be more specific, this is the third topic in unit number 1. Okay, so this is the course outcome for this unit: describe multi-core architecture and identify the characteristics and challenges. So this falls under K2 category, understanding level. So this is going to be agenda of my today's presentation. Okay, so first I'm going to give a short introduction about interconnect. Then there are basically two types of interconnect over there: shared memory interconnect and the distributed memory interconnect. So under shared memory interconnect, again we got two classification: buses and crossbars. After that we are going to discuss about distributed memory interconnect, and in distributed memory interconnect there are again two variants are the direct interconnect and indirect interconnect. And under direct interconnect we got three variants: ring, two dimension toroidal mesh and hypercube. And in indirect interconnect we got two more variants: distributed memory crossbar and omega network. Okay, let us go to today's class. Okay, so interconnect. Okay, we all know that to connect two computers we need a network, we need a setup called as network. Okay, this network will connect two or more computers, okay, through something called as network. Okay, so using this network these computers can communicate with each other. Okay, the data will be transmitted from one computer to another computer. So today's internet is a very very big application of this network. Okay, today's internet is a very very big application of this network. Okay, likewise, okay, we all know that there are multiple cores available in a processor. We should create some platform so that these processes, these cores can communicate with each other. Okay, that platform is called as interconnect networks. Okay, using this interconnect network cores can communicate with each other. Okay, and it plays major role in performance of shared memory and distributed memory system. Okay, so let us see what are all the different variants available in the shared memory interconnect. So there are two widely used shared memory interconnects are there. One is called as bus, the other one is called as crossbus. Okay, bus is a very traditional one. Okay, buses will be like this is more like bus topology in main internet. Okay, there will be multiple cores will be there. Okay, all these cores will be connected to a common bus. Okay, this bus in turn will connect to memory. Okay, so if this particular processor wants to access this memory, then this will access this memory through this bus only. So usually the data which is fetched from memory will be broadcasted to all the cores. Okay, like similar to that in bus topology. Okay, so what are the advantages of bus? Means buses will have low implementation cost, and you can connect multiple devices. Okay, then it will be very flexible if you connect multiple devices. Okay, without adding any extra cost to the system. Okay, you can connect multiple devices, multiple cores. Okay, these are all the advantages of bus interconnect. If you take this advantage, okay, the second advantage will be converted as a disadvantage, okay, if we keep on connecting more cores, okay, if we keep on connecting more cores, okay, obviously the performance of the bus interconnect will get decreased. Okay, that is one big disadvantage. The another disadvantage is if more cores are connected to a bus interconnect, then processor will take turn to access the memory. Okay, in turn, this may increase the waiting time of core. Okay, so this is going to affect directly the performance of the system. Okay, so if you are using a very small, if you have a dual core memory or dual core processor or a tri core processor or a quad core processor, this type of interconnect may be good. Maybe up to tri core it may be good. Okay, if you are going to increase more cores, then this type of interconnect will not be that much recommended. Okay, so next one is crossbar switch. So this is how a crossbar switch will look like. So there will be some multiple processors will be there and memories will be there. Okay, you'll use something like a switch to connect this processor and memory. Okay, and to control the data among this crossbar, we'll use something called as switch. Okay, this switch device will control and route the data among this line, which is called as crossbar. Okay, usually this crossbar will be bidirectional. That is a very important point. Please make a note of it. Okay, because there is another device in future we'll discuss. That device will be unidirectional. Okay, communication links are usually bidirectional. Okay, you can send data and receive data in a single line. Okay, this circle represents switches, and this line represent crossbars. Okay, there is another diagram available in the next PPT. I'll tell you detail. Okay, so this is how a crossbar will look like, and this is how a crossbar switch will look like. Okay, and this is the closed portion, this is the open portion. Okay, so if have a look at this diagram, C diagram. Okay, what is happening here is P1 is writing some data in M4. Okay, P1 is writing some data in P4, and P2 is reading some data in M3. Okay, P2 is reading some data in M3, and P3 is reading something from M1. Okay, and what is happening in P4? P4 is writing something in M2. Okay, this is what happens. Okay, yeah. Okay. So what are the advantages of crossbar switch? Okay, this when compared to bus, this is faster. Okay, and the performance is good when there is simultaneous access. Okay, when you're accessing memory, or when you're communicating with a fellow core, then the performance will be good when compared to bus. Okay, the main disadvantages of this crossbar switch is somewhat costly, not that much costly, but it is costly when compared to switch, when compared to bus. Sorry. Okay, so this is about shared memory interconnect. Also, in shared memory interconnect, we got two types of interconnect. There are many types of interconnect available, but these two are very famous. Take it like that. Okay, buses and crossbars. So next we are going to discuss about distributed memory interconnect. Guys, hope I'm audible. Okay, distributed memory interconnect, and in distributed memory interconnect, again we are dividing distributed memory interconnect devices into two major groups. One is direct interconnect, and the other one is indirect interconnect. Okay, so direct interconnect. So as the name suggests, we will connect the cores directly. Okay, this is an example for a direct interconnect. Okay, we are assuming that we are in a 6-core environment. Okay, we are in a 6-core environment, hexa-core environment. All the other cores are connected with a particular core through a direct line. Okay, this may look somewhat tedious, but the performance of this type of interconnect will be awesome. Okay, but the construction of these type of interconnect is somewhat tedious, and also it will be costly. Okay, so this is also called as fully connected network. Okay, this is also called as fully connected network, and there are three types of direct interconnects are there. One is link. Okay, the second one is called as two-dimensional tri-nodal mesh, and the third one is called as hyperfield. Okay, I'm repeating again, the reason for calling this type of interconnect as direct interconnect is two cores will be connected directly. Okay, for example, let us assume this is core 1 and this is core 2. These two cores are connected directly, and this is core 1 and core 3. These two cores are connected directly. Okay, directly it is connected. That's why it is called as direct interconnect. Okay, and there are three variants in it: a ring, a two-dimensional tri-nodal mesh, and four-nodal mesh, and the third one is called as hyperfield. Okay, first type of interconnect is called as ring interconnect, and in ring interconnect, usually multiple simultaneous communication will be there. Usually, you can compare this with the ring topology in network. Okay. The adjacent cores will be connected. Okay, for example, P1 and P2 are adjacent cores, so these two are connected, and P2 and P3 are adjacent cores, so these two are connected. Again, from P3 there will be a connection between P3 and P1. Okay, it will be like a ring. After connecting, so this will in turn come and connect here. Okay, so if there are n processors are there, then there will be some 2n links will be there. Okay, if there are three processor or three cores, okay, then there will be 6 links will be there. Okay, advantages. Okay, the advantages is it is very simple to implement, and this is very less expensive when compared to other type of direct interconnects. Okay, now. So the main disadvantage of this type of interconnect is, even though it is very simple in nature and simple to implement, okay, even though it is very simple to implement and very simple in nature, the main disadvantage of this interconnect is if P1 wants to send some, let us assume this interconnect consists of some more cores. Okay, if first core wants to send some data to third core. Okay, we got 4-core environment. Okay, if first core wants to send some data to the third core, and if second core is accessing the network, then first core needs to wait until second core completed its task. So this is going to be again, this is going to increase the waiting time of core. So this is going to pull down the performance of the system. Okay, so even though it is cost effective, it degrades the performance of the system. So you should be very careful when you are going for this type of interconnect. Okay. The next is toroidal mesh. So toroidal mesh, we have some complex arrangement of switches. Okay, and the links will be triple the number of processor. If there is three processors out there, then there will be nine links will be there. So this is how toroidal mesh will look like. Okay, first the toroidal mesh processors are connected horizontally and vertically. Okay, horizontally it is connected. Okay, vertically also it is connected. So if you look at this in in a three-dimensional environment, it will be more more visible to you. Okay, in two-dimensional environment, this is somewhat difficult to imagine. Okay, please please imagine this in a three-dimensional environment. It will be very 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 good. Okay, so main advantage of this type of system is it has a very good connectivity when compared to the ring. So there is you can reduce the waiting time. Okay, and the simultaneous communication can be done easily. Okay, you don't want to wait for other processor to complete its task. Okay, if one route is blocked, you can take another route. Main problem with the ring topology, if there is a break in the route, okay, there is less chance for taking another route. Okay, the main disadvantage of this type of connectivity is it is somewhat complex in nature. Okay, this is complex when compared to ring topology. Ring topology is very simple to implement, whereas this toroidal mesh is somewhat complex, and also it is more expensive when compared to ring topology. Okay, so ring interconnect traditional. So that's it about toroidal mesh. The next one is called as hyperport. This is more complex network. This is a very complex network. Okay, usually we will go to this type of interconnect when we are building a inductive system. Okay, inductive system in the sense we are going to excuse me. Okay, but so if you are going to design a hot plug system, let us assume you are going to design a hot plug system. Hot plug system means you can connect devices when the system is running, like USB. Like USB, you can connect or disconnect any devices. Okay, when the system is switched on. So usually, supercomputers are designed in this way. Okay. So if we are designing such inductive system, okay, we usually will go for this hyperclear. Okay, this hyperclear queue will give better performance when compared to other interconnects. Okay, the only problem with this type of interconnect is it is somewhat complex to build. Okay, other than that, it gives a very 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 awesome performance. Okay, so this is considered as very highly connected interconnect because there will be many connections running between cores. Okay, if you take one dimension, if we take only two cubes, okay, if there is if you take a two cube, you will connect those two core. Okay, if you take two cores, okay, those two cores will be connected directly. Okay, that is called as one dimensional hyperport. Okay, the understanding will be very better if you take this. Okay, if you are connecting two cores, okay, we will connect like this. Okay, if you take four cores, you will connect like this. Okay, if you want to connect more than two cores, okay, then you will connect like this. Okay, this is like a single dimensional environment, this is like a two dimensional environment, and this will be called as three-dimensional environment, and you can keep on increasing like this. Okay, you can keep on increasing like this. You can go to some n dimension. Sorry, and usually if you have d dimension, then d processes and d number of switches can be used. And the main advantage of this type of system is it has very good connectivity when compared to ring and toroidal mesh. Okay, and the main disadvantage of this type of interconnect is it is more powerful switches is needed, and also it is very expensive. Okay, if you are going for constructing a supercomputer, usually you will not bother much about expense. Okay, so if you want a very powerful computer, you can better go for this type of basis, this type of integral. Okay. So next is indirect interconnect. Okay. Indirect interconnect, in indirect interconnect. Guys, please make yourself your muted. Okay. Okay, hope I'm audible. And as the name suggests, interconnect. As the name suggests, there is no direct connection between cores. Okay. What happens here is you will connect the cores to a device called as switch. Okay. You will connect the cores to a device called as switch. This switch in turn will take care about sending the data to another port. Okay. So one more very important thing about this interconnect is it contains unidirectional link. Okay. There is a unidirectional link between core and processor. Sorry, switch and processor. Dear Swaya, kindly make your please make sure you are muted. Again, I'm getting some noise from your side. So, cores are connected to network using a unidirectional link.
Since
it is a unidirectional link, okay, unidirectional connection between processor and switch, there will be an incoming line and there will be an outgoing line. Okay, incoming line line will be a line from a switch to core. The outgoing line will be between core to the switch. Okay, and again there are few classifications in indirect interconnect. One is called as distributed memory crossbar. The other one is called as Omega network. Okay, and this is how a distributed memory crossbar will look like. Okay, the cores will be connected to a series of switches. Okay, each switch will connect to another core. Okay, if let us assume this is core 1, core 2, core 3, core 4. Then if core 1 wants to connect with this core 3, what it will do is the core 1 will send the data all the way to this fourth switch. Since it is broadcast, it will send the data all the way to fourth switch. Okay, what switch 3 will do is switch 3 will establish a connection between this switch, and it will take the data to third core. Likewise, if the third core wants to connect with the fourth core, what it will do is it will send the data all the way to switch 4. Again, the switch 4 will take the data to core 4. All the other switches will be closed. Only this switch will be open. Okay, so this will take the data to. So this is how the data transmission in distributed memory crossbar will happen. Okay. Please remember one thing in distributed memory crossbar. The link is unidirectional, whereas in shared memory crossbar it is bidirectional. So since it is bidirectional, this setup will not be there. Okay. Only this setup will be there in bidirectional. Whereas in unidirectional, you got another setup like this. Okay. Okay, there is a problem with this distributed memory interconnect. If you want to have a communicate, simultaneous communication between processor. Okay, so what the restriction is, if you want to have a simultaneous conversation with another processor, you should make sure that the target processor is not communicating with any other processor at the same time. Okay, and in distributed memory cross bus, the advantage of distributed memory cross bus is you can have a simultaneous conversation up to a certain extent. Okay, and the main disadvantage is, again, it is related to communication. Okay, if two processor tries to communicate with the same processor at same time, then there will be a problem. Then we will go for something called as priority or some kind of thing we have to do. Okay, we have to solve that programmatically. Okay, we cannot solve it in the circuit. Okay, we have to deal this type of problem in program only. Okay. So next one is Omega network. The last one is Omega network. So Omega network is like usually there'll be more than there'll be two crossbars to build Omega network. Okay, two crossbars will be used for building Omega network. And again, here simultaneous communication is not possible. Okay. Since simultaneous communication is not possible, we have to do only serial communication. Okay, if there is a p number of processor, okay, then the network will use as 2x2 cross bus switches. Okay, each and every processor will use 2x2 switches will be there. So therefore, the Omega network will need 2p switches. Okay, that many switches are needed. So this is somewhat a complex network to build, and to build this Omega network is a very complex and tedious one. So this is obviously, this is going to be somewhat a costly thing. Okay, these are all the references I created for used for creating this PPT. And do you have any doubts, guys? Thank you, Darbhuta. Thank you, Abhishitra. Thank you, Lavanya. Okay, if there is no doubt, then we can wind up the session. Okay, thank you very much, guys. Thank you very much for listening to my lengthy lecture for the past 30 or 35 minutes. Please stay home and stay safe. Have a nice day. Bye.